All right. I think we're live. Okay. Yes, we are. Okay. So, hello everyone. We'll do the introduction slowly since we're 1 minute early. But hello everyone. Welcome to our online quantum chaos seminars. Thank you for attending one more time. I'll just mention, just in case, that I know that we have a very nice turnout. So in case we have some people that haven't attended these seminars before, let me just remind you that the way you know this works is that you'll be seeing the presentation, and you'll be hearing the speaker through the stream, and that you can interact with us and with the speaker through the live chat on the side of the screen. And we encourage you to ask questions throughout the talk, and especially at the end. And remember that we have a little bit of a delay, so don't be shy in asking those questions. And once you have them, just post them out there, and we'll transfer it to the speaker. Okay. So we'll start today with our talk. It is really our pleasure to welcome Professor Ana Maria Rey from GILA and the University of Colorado. Ana Maria is a world-renowned expert in all things quantum, and she's a reference in the field of quantum antibody dynamics, quantum simulation, and atomic and molecular optics. She did her PhD at the University of Maryland and later worked in NIST Gettysburg and ITAM Harvard. And Ana Maria is now a professor adjoint at the University of Colorado, as well as a fellow of GILA and NIST. And I should also mention that during her career, she has won many amazing awards, including MacArthur Fellowship and the Presidential Early Career Award for Scientists and Engineers. And so we are very excited to have Ana Maria here. Thank you again for joining us in our online seminars. And you can take it away whenever you're ready.
Great. Thank you, Pablo and Peter, for the nice invitation to present a seminar in this series, Quantum Chaos. Well, it's really nice to have the opportunity to tell you a little bit about our work at GILA, at NIST. The talk that I'm going to give you today is understanding the entanglement dynamics in an array of trapped ions. So our goal here is trying to use these systems as testbeds of how entanglement propagates in a closed system. On one hand, the task is to engineer highly entangled states, but on the other hand, is try to access the process of quantum thermalization in closed system, understanding at the microscopic level how a scrambling of quantum information happens in these systems and the direct connections to chaos that is at the heart of this quantum series. And well, our goal, our aim is trying to understand if we can really use microscopic systems that are highly controlled emulate complex phenomena, and in particular, shed light in quantum gravity, for example, through the holographic principle, and try to really connect not only AMO but to different fields. And this gives the starting of my talk, it's related to the excitement that I have in seeing fields that were used to be disparate, now all interested in the same type of questions that are common between them. So if you think now, is AMO physics, condensed matter physics, general relativity, and high energy used to be completely disconnected, and now people in the different communities are talking to each other and interested in progress that is made. And the beauty or the connection, the link is quantum information that is developing tools and terminology that is useful for all these fields through the understanding of the phenomenon of entanglement propagation in many body systems. So our goal is try to, as I mentioned before, use a fully controllable system, and in this case, is trapped ions, trying to be this connection, and hopefully trying to find ways that we can understand how a microscopic systems can help describe black holes, horizons, emergent space-time in these non-equilibrium systems. All right, so in order to start my talk, let me first acknowledge my collaborators. So the work that I'm going to be talking about has been done in the experimental group of John Bollinger at NIST, and the faces that I'm showing here, Justin Bonnet and Kevin Gilmore, are the people who have taken the data that I'm going to present. And of course, to my theory group, in particular, Robert Lewis-Swan and Agar Gavansafani Naini, both they were postdocs at that time, and now they are starting their own faculty positions very soon this summer, or Aragavan already started, and other group members, Michael Foss, Michael Wall, and Martin Garner, did all the calculations that I'm going to present. All right, so because this talk is about trapped ions, let me start by introducing you the system that we are studying. These are planar arrays of 2D crystals of trapped ions. The system is beryllium ions. And in the experiment, they can prepare arrays that vary from 20 ions to arrays as large as 300 ions. So these are actual experimental pictures, and these spots that you see are real ions in the system, in the array. So these arrays are generated in what is called a penning trap, that is just a set of electrodes, static electrodes that give an axial confinement along the vertical direction, along this direction, there is a strong magnetic field generated by a superconducting magnet. So the idea is that this introduces also this introduces, there are some electrodes that introduce rotation, and the rotation of charged particles in the presence of this strong field introduces the radial confinement that generate this type of 2D arrays. Now, if we look at the microscopic degree of freedom, we are going to have two hyperfine states in the beryllium ions that are going to encode and spin 1/2 degrees of freedom. They are separated by an energy splitting of the order of 100 gigahertz, and this is introduced by this Tesla strength B field generated by the magnet. The point I just want to emphasize is that they have been able to generate very high single qubit gates in this system rotations, arbitrary rotations with very high fidelity. Fidelity is as high as 99.9 fidelity. So this is how you can control individual ions, but we also need to generate interactions. And the point is that the ions in the crystal are spaced so far apart that direct exchange interactions via Coulomb interactions are too tiny. So the way that we make these ions talk is by using lasers. Especially we use two Raman beams that are separated by a bit node frequency nu. And this mid nu frequency, what it generates is, in addition to this, to the laser beams, that generates a moving LED lattice, and the experimentalists set the polarization and the intensity of the beams such that they generate a spin-dependent force. So that's all what you need to know here. So we can engineer a force that is acting on the ions in such a way. You can see here this sigma C is the Pauli matrix acting on ion J. So that means that the force is in the up direction. If, for example, if you are pointing up, a spin up, and if you are in the opposite spin, the force in the opposite direction. So what we do is that we generate a spin-dependent force, and it's time-dependent. And the time dependent is set by this bit node frequency nu that we set to excite different type of vibrational modes in the crystal. So basically, if I look at the picture, what happens is that this is the crystal, and the crystal has phonons, and in particular, we are interested in the transverse modes, the Drumhead modes. I'm trying to do kind of a cartoon of how these modes look like in the crystal. Let's see. Sometimes this animation is not that as good. Let's see. Okay, you can see some of the motion of these modes. So in part, so the important part is that these modes couple the spins with the spins. And what we can do is that we can set this bit node frequency, mu, such that we can excite the modes that we want. So if we set the bit node frequency close to the center of mass mode, then we are only excite this mode and the others are of resonance. But in principle, if they want, experimentalists can excite all of them. But for this talk, we ignore the other modes and we only focus in the center of mass mode, because what we do is that we are very close. We set the bit node only to excite it. So we have a parameter delta that is going to be the tuning of my bit node with the frequency of the center of mass. And we go to the rotating frame of the ions, of the phonons. We can see that the Hamiltonian that describes the full system, when in this case, is just the center of mass creation and annihilation operator that are detuned by delta, and then the force between the spins and the ions is encoded in this term, because in the center of mass, all the ions move together. Then instead of having individual spins, I can define a collective spin operator SC that is the sum over all individual spins. So I'm just going to have in this talk, instead of a bunch of spin 1/2 particles, a big collective spin. And in this case, the Hamiltonian is a coupling between the x position of the center of mass mode to the SC operator. So you can stare at this formula, then you can imagine that this formula is just giving you a displaced harmonic oscillator. So this is x squared plus p squared, and this is x. So this is displaced harmonic oscillator, and I mean, you naively, in order to diagonalize the system, all what you need to do is try to complete the square. I mean, you can define a displaced operator, and you can imagine that for a single spin, for example, what it happens is that the trap center is displaced to the right for a spin up and to the left for a spin down. So this is just a displaced oscillator, and then you have the term that is SC squared, that is a collective Hamiltonian acting on the spins only. So in principle, as you can see, there is coupling between the center of mass mode and the spins. But if you think about this harmonic oscillator picture, if we start with that coherent state at the center, then it's going to oscillate. And this oscillation, and let's see if I can set maybe this cartoon here. Okay, well, I don't know what is this. It's at the center, I mean, this oscillator is going to start to do, if you have a coherent state, it's going to do oscillations, dipole oscillations, and every multiple of the trap frequency, the spins are going to go back to the original state. And therefore, at this multiple times of the period of the oscillations, then we can see that the spins and the phonons decouple. And what the experiment is doing is going to take only measurements at these decoupled times, where the spins and the phonons completely decouple and the Hamiltonian reduced to a simple JC squared Hamiltonian with J, this coupling constant, is inversely proportional to the detune. That's going to be important later in the talk. So that is the coupling constants that describe this collective behavior, that this Hamiltonian is known in the literature as a one-axis twisting model, is well known to generate a squeezing in the system. And that's the first case that I'm going to focus our discussion. Okay, so we have this Hamiltonian, and the question that I want to ask is how entanglement generates in this very simple system. Is a large spin that is nonlinear, SC squared. So the idea is that we are going to prepare initially an uncorrelated state, let it evolve with this intra-Hamiltonian, and then try to understand how entanglement is built up during the dynamics. So what we are going to do to characterize the buildup of entanglement is that we use the standard tools that quantum information has taught us in the recent years. And for example, is the context of entanglement entropy. For that, let me define a density matrix of my full system. Of course, trace of rho has to be one, but we are going to have we are interested in closed systems where trace of rho squared is equal to one. So we are going to define a purity in my in that of this order one, because we have a closed system, and I'm going to divide my system, however, into a subsystem A and subsystem B, and I'm going to define the reduced density matrix of my system A by tracing over the rest of the system B. And when I look at the properties of my density matrix, reduced density matrix, what I can define is kind of the purity of this the reduced density matrix, and this purity can be related with the Rainy entropy of order two, just by the logarithm of the purity. And the point is, if I have, this is a measurement of quantifier of entanglement, because if I have a product state, then when I trace over my subsystem B, then the point is that when I trace over my subsystem B, then I don't lose any information when I trace over B, and therefore my subsystem A remains pure. And in this case, I going to have a Rainy entropy of zero. But nevertheless, if I let my system evolve and the system A becomes entangled with system B, then what happens is that then when I cut A over the subsystem B, then I'm going to generate loss information. And this loss of information in my subsystem B is going to translate into a Rainy entropy that is larger than zero. And this idea is at the heart of thermalization in closed systems, and by the fact that I'm going to, this entanglement is what making a pure system apparently behave as a thermal state after some time evolution when the system becomes entanglement. And because if I look at local observables associated with my subsystem A, I can see that I apparently lost coherence, and this coherence or loss of information is just that is getting entangled with the rest of the system and they store in the many body degrees of freedom of the whole system. And interestingly, I mean, this apparent loss of information in a quantum system has direct connections with through entanglement has also been the language that or the way that it has been approached in or to explain what is called the information paradox in black holes, when an object enters into a horizon of a black hole and the information is lost. And the idea here is that not necessarily this information is lost, but actually stored in the many body degrees of freedom of this complex black hole. So that's one of the interesting connections that just entanglement has allowed between these very different systems. And we want to a little bit understand how this information is built up in the many body degrees of freedom of the system. And you can imagine that, of course, if you want to try to access this, you have to measure many body correlation in the systems. And it's not a trivial task, but a few years ago, the group of Markus Greiner at Harvard, using his quantum gas microscope, was actually able to prove actually this idea that the information gets scrambled in the many body degrees of freedom of the system by looking at simple systems of just two arrays of six bosonic particles in his quantum gas microscope. And what they did is they measured the Rainy entropy of the different parts of the system, starting from one, two, or the middle of the system. They saw that, in fact, as expected, the Rainy entropy grow linearly with the system size, as we expect for small parts of the array. And then as they go to the middle, the Rainy entropy stops growing, it saturates and go back to zero as you expect from a closed system. So that was very beautiful measurements done in this group. But the issue here is that, well, they were done in very small systems. And what we want to do is actually try to understand this more complex process in a many body system. So I have to say that in the last couple of years, they have been great progress trying to access Rainy entropy in larger systems. For example, in the group of Reiner Blatt, they were able to measure randomized measurements trying to access Rainy entropy, and they succeeded in systems of up to 20 ions. That is great, but I mean our goal is to try to access similar information in our ion crystal that can have up to 100 or 200 ions. So the question is, is there any way that we can actually accomplish this task? And well, sure, it comes, the first thing that we did, although we will see is the minimal instance of those measurements, is what about if we try to measure just the Rainy entropy of a single block. I mean, not go to the full system, just start by very local measurements. And in our case, it's really simple. You can show for this analytic SC-squared model that the Rainey entropy of a single block is just related, if you start with a state pointing along the x direction, is just related with the magnetization along x. So if you measure the collective magnetization along x, the projection of the spin along x, the length along x, and then you can first get an analytic expression for the collective observable Sx. You can show that it decays as a Gaussian at short times with a power law that depends on n. So and the Rainey entropy, therefore, what it does is start in zero and then saturates at the maximal value that you can get for a single ion. So the system fully thermalizes for this system. And then, well, we have an integrable system. It's quite trivial, so you cannot avoid to have these collapses and revivals. But well, at the middle of the evolution, of then you get a maximal thermal state of a single ion. And this is one-to-one with the fact that the collective magnetization goes to zero. That means the systems completely decohere in this apparently decohere, and this is just caused by the buildup of entanglement at a rate, say, by J. Okay, so this is simple, and this is one of the first things that we try to measure in the experiment, and indeed, we see that. And we saw that, so we see this apparently the coherence of the in the system. I have to disclaim that we have not completely a pure system. We have some sorts of this coherence via light scattering, but it's small, so we could quantify how much the coherence we get in the system if we don't have any type of interactions, spin-spin interactions, and we used to set the bound, and then we did measurements of the collective spins after starting the spins with all along x. And we changed the size of our crystal from 20 to 200 ions. I mean, this is an increasing size. The dots are experimental points. The solid lines are theory that also account with the small decoherence. And you can see that we definitely see the polarization to the magnetization of the system. And we put a scale of the curves with this n scaling that we expect from this simple behavior. And we see all of them collapse as we expect. So we were seeing first manifestation of buildup of entanglement in this system. But of course, this is just a local observable. We want to go more. So in order to go more, there was a very interesting development that actually to access scrambling can be done, not necessarily through measurements of the Rainey entropy. I'm going to tell you a little bit later the connection to Rainey entropy, but instead there was a concept of hour of time order correlator that was proposed by the quantum information and high energy community. That is this orphan object that made of four operators. One operator apply at time t equal to zero, then another operator W at time at time t after the system evolves. Then you have go backwards in time and measure, apply B at a and then W again after time evolution. So you can see that is out of or time order. And this complex object actually is just related with the commutator of these two operators W and B that are set to commute at time t equal to zero. But because of the time evolution, this W stopped to commute with B, and the degree of non-commutativity can be formally shown to be a measurement of the scrambling. So that's very nice. So we have this other object that can tell us how much the system is scrambling. And the other important connection, and emphasizing again what we want to go beyond and try to understand more complex systems and connections with quantum gravity, is that it has been shown that actually black holes seems to be the objects in nature that scramble information at the fastest rate possible. And this commutator actually grows with a rate, is exponential, and this exponent is associated with the quantum Lyapunov exponent, kind of there is a connection with this, and it was said that this Lyapunov exponent is the largest possible in the system and is bound by the temperature in this case. So this is a bound of chaos that has demonstrated it by Maldacena and many others in a very exciting way. So there is a bound of chaos, there is a bound of thermalization, and there are objects that thermalize very quickly. So then the question is, if there is a way that we can access this out of time order correlation in our quantum systems and try to make some connection between what we are seeing and what they were predicting for black holes. And well, definitely, and I think they were prior talks in this series. There was the first proposal of Brian Swingle that they said, yes, we have a scheme talk how to measure this. And following Brian, there were other proposals. But I mean, in our system, we have a very, very simple way to measure autox that was natural for the experiment at hand. So this was our proposal. So our proposal is the following. So what about if we prepare a simple state, all the spins polarized, for example, along X. Then we let the system evolve with our Hamiltonian. And then after some time t, we apply a perturbation W. And that what the next step is just to undo the dynamics by just reversing the sign of our Hamiltonian from H to minus H, waiting the same amount of time. And after that, I measure an observable B. So mathematically, what we are doing is that is prepare an initial state, evolve, perturb, undo the evolution, the evolution, and measure B. And the only necessary condition for us was that this B operator needs to be, and phi needs to be related in this way. So phi is an eigenstate of B. So if this condition is satisfied, with no harm, I can perfectly put this B here, and there is this inequality. And if you read what is written here, this is B, the time evolved W, B, and the time evolved W. So exactly, this is in the form of the autox. And that was the simple protocol that we used to measure autox in this experiment. So of course, we have to use particular observables, and we need to develop the capability to undo the Hamiltonian. Okay, so what did we do in the experiment to invert the many body dynamics? Actually quite simple, because we have only one mode in our system, and the coupling constant, as I mentioned at the beginning, was set by the detuning of my bit knob. So I control this with a laser, with the frequency of my laser. And the only thing that I need to do is to change my frequency from the blue of the center of mass to the red. So just want to change delta to minus delta, that can be done very simple in the experiment. That was the only requirement for undo the time evolution. And the observable that we choose to measure that is very easy and accessible in the experiment is rotation. So the W was a rotation along X, and our B operator is SX. So we measure the magnetization. That's the same measurement that I showed you before when we look at the single Rayleigh entropy. And okay, something that we did beyond, and I'm going to justify a little bit that later, but sometimes instead of measuring a single rotation, we apply many, many different rotations, phi. And what we did is we took the Fourier transform of the measurements that we got as a function of phi. And this Fourier amplitude, we call it AM. This is the Fourier transform of all these rotations that we did. And this quantity is what we plot here. So at time t equal to zero, we have a system where only the m equal to zero component was populated, and we let the time evolve. And actually we could show, I cannot show it here, but you can look at our paper if you want details, that the m degree, how much m component I'm populated is a measurement of how many m body correlations I have. So I start a product state, m equal to zero. And if I go and have non-zero value of m equal to two, that means I have 2-point correlators, two particles are entangled. If I have four, mean I have four particles entangled, and so forth. So in the experiments, we were able to measure the BLAB of entanglement of two m bodies. So I think after m equal to eight, the signal kind of disappears. I mean, of course, in the theory it continues, and unfortunately, it's because we are competed with single particle defacing that washes out our signal. So, but in that way, we were able to measure a scrambling. I mean, not something exponential, not something really completely exciting, because it's just a simple model, a C squared. But I mean, it tells us in the experiment that yes, the entanglement is built up sequentially as a function of time. Okay, so that was our first experiment. I mean, we're happy with that. But on the other hand, of course, that's not the goal. The goal was trying to see if we can emulate fast scrambling. So the question is how we can do that. How can make add complexity to the system to make the scrambling faster? And actually, we have two ingredients that were very simple to add in our system. So the first ingredient is that we add a transverse field. So in that sense, it doesn't commute with the C Hamiltonian that we have. And second, we stop to take in measurements at spectroscopic times. Actually, when you add a transverse field, there is not any more than a spectroscopy, a time where you can decouple the spin for the phonons. So spins of the phonons are coupled. So we have both spins and phonons alive and interacting to each other. And in this case, the Hamiltonian that we implement is the so-called Dicke model that is just two harmonic oscillators coupled to each other. So it's an spin and a field operator A. Again, this field operator for us is the center of mass motion and the presence of a transverse field. So the Dicke model has been an iconic model in quantum optics for many, many years. I mean, it was proposed by Dicke in the 50s. But in fact, this model has not implemented in real experiment. It was more like a theoretical abstractions up to recently, where in 2010, the group of Tiedemann Esslinger implemented for the first time the Dicke model in a cavity. Using instead of real spins, he used two internal states, momentum states of rubidium atoms. With this implementation, there was later implementation by the group of Murray Barrett using a cavity system and again rubidium atoms. And then in 2018, I mean, we tried to demonstrate that our system actually implements the Dicke model. So if you want more information, you can look at this paper. I'm going to summarize briefly what we did to benchmark our simulation. And then this is going to be the starting point to use it for dynamics. So in order to benchmark the simulation of the Dicke model, we use the fact that the Dicke model has rich physics, and in particular, it features a quantum phase transition as you vary the magnetization B, for example, the transverse field. And so this is in units of 1 over B. And what happens is that there are two phases that are separated at a critical value of this transverse field that actually is the value of of J that was appearing in the spin model. Okay, so what is happening? So if B is large, then if B is large, this coupling is irrelevant, and you have two decoupled oscillators, the phonons and the spins, and that means the ground state of the system is just the vacuum of the phonons, no phonons, and a spin pointing along the direction of the magnetic of the transverse field. Okay, it's a paramagnetic state because the spins point exactly along the direction of the field. But now, if we go instead and decrease the field B, then this term becomes important. And as we were doing before in the first slide, it's better to do a transformation where you translate, you displace the bosonic field and by amount that is set by SC to actually complete the square here. And you have a Hamiltonian that is coupled, is delta B daga B, that the B depends on the spins and the phonons, and the SC operators, before we call this term J, let me call now this B critical. So the point is that the ground state of the system is going to be the vacuum of the B operator, and a spin, because you have a negative sign here, is a ferromagnetic state. So notice that the vacuum of the B is a displaced vacuum state for the A. That means a coherent state with a macroscopic equation of phonons that if the spins are polarized along NC, can grow within. So it's a macroscopic population of phonons, of the real phonons of the center of mass mode. And in fact, you can show that the ground state is a cat state. It's a superposition of a spin up and a coherent state, and a spin down and a coherent state displaced to the other side. It's really a cat state. And that's what we try to see, if we can see somehow the transition between the normal and the superfluid phase to benchmark our simulator. So in order to look at this phase transition, what you can do is trying to adiabatically move the magnetic field or the effective field, starting from a very strong field where our eigenstates is all the spins pointing along the x direction and zero of the phonons. Unfortunately, at that time, the lowest temperature that they could prepare were six, but I mean, we were not exactly in the ground state, a little bit excited. I mean, now they have the capability to decrease the phonons to zero, but in 2 years back, no. But okay, so we started with almost the ground state of the system at large B, and the idea is to decrease the B slowly, go to the critical point, and go to the other phase. In order to be slowly, you have to be slow respect to the gap of the many body system. So the slowest that you are, the best. We could not do as slowest as we could because there is decoherence. So there is a cutoff time that is 2 milliseconds where we need to ramp. But still, we could show that we saw these two phases. How we did that? Well, we look at the distributions of the spins. This is the M number along the C direction, the distribution. This is the experiment. This is the theory. We use two different type of ramps, an exponential ramp or a linear ramp. This is the exponential. This is the linear. This is a function of time. At time t equal to zero, we prepare a spin polarized along the X direction. So it's a coherent state, a maximum. So it's peak the distribution along C equal to zero. It's a Gaussian distribution. And then as we tune and drop the field slowly, we see that at a critical point that is set by this black line, you see a transition from one distribution to two peaks in the distribution that is the ferromagnet. So this is experiment, this is theory. So it's a little bit not perfect because as I said, we didn't start in the ground state, but the theory account for that. But we did see the transition. So we were happy, we have the model. Now let's move to dynamics in the system. I mean, we didn't have entanglement here, of course, but we did generate the ground state in one of the branches, the two, either this or this one is superposition, not a superposition, but okay. So now let's look at dynamics. And for that, let's look at the rich physics of the decay model beyond the ground state. And I it's interesting when I was looking at, I didn't know that so rich physics could happen in such simple model. In fact, if you look at the energy spectrum, you find that besides the ground state phase transition, there are a bunch of excited state phase transitions at a critical, at the energy of the ground state energy of the normal states. These excited state transitions are characterized by change in the level structure, the level in the energy spectrum, the space in between adjacent energy space in the system. So the interesting part is that if you go to the normal phase, if all the excited and you look at the spectrum is Poissonian-like. So this means that the system is integrable in the case where the normal phase with the spins dominate. Now, if you go to the super radiant phase when you have both the spins and phonons highly contributing, I mean, not decoupled like here, where they are coupled, you see that there are two different type of level statistics. If you go to high energies, above this dynamic steady state phase transition, you see that distribution becomes Wigner Dyson. I mean, there is level repulsion of the spectrum, and therefore you expect some chaotic behavior in the system, as typically signature by this Wigner Dyson. And then we have, I see a typo, my apologies. And then you have the low energy spectrum. There is not Poissonian, not Wigner Dyson, it's kind of a mixture of both, but this depends on, of course, finite size effects and many things, but in the low energy, you can see it's more like Poissonian than Wigner Dyson. So there is a changing character of the distribution in the super radiant phase. So we wanted to understand a little bit this more and see how this can connect to a scrambling of quantum information. So the first thing that we did is to start but mean field and try to see if there is a connection to classical chaos. So what we go is that we have our system, we go to phase space and look at the evolution of SX, YSC, the real and imaginary part of A, and we try to compute the Lyapunov exponent. That means if you have two trajectories and we want to see how fast they separate in phase space as a function of time, if there is a positive exponent, it's the Lyapunov exponent, is associated with the butterfly effect and signature of classical chaos. Otherwise, you don't have that. And these are the calculations that Robert and Argaban did. So they did see that in the region where you expect Wigner-Dyson statistics, the Lyapunov exponent was large. Whereas in the other regions, it was is small. And actually, the Lyapunov exponent was the largest at this excited state phase transition. So at the least, we see what we wanted to see from the spectrum to the classical mean field trajectories. Now, let's go to at the heart of the talk and try to see what is if there is any connection between this classical chaos to quantum chaos and scrambling. And for that, the proposal is to measure one specific type of autox that we call photox from fidelity autox. What I'm going to tell you is that these objects can all allow us to connect between classical and quantum chaos to scrambling and thermalization, also to entanglement. So they are very rich. They contain a lot of information. The photox, just to remind you, because I was just saying that before, a few slides ago, so you take your system, do the evolution, apply a perturbation, undo the dynamics, and the B now that we measure is the fidelity to B in the initial state. That's the photox. The B now is this fidelity. And what we do, again, is to do the Fourier transform for different phi, and we extract the Fourier components. Why? Well, because actually NMR discovered autox many, many years ago. I mean, the NMRs are the expert, and they knew about this many years ago, and they call it multiple quantum coherence spectrum. So just to explain, if you have one spin, we clearly know that the coherence are the off-diagonal parts of your density matrix. They are useful for superposition, phase sensitivity, many things. So we are very familiar with single spin, single particle coherences. But in NMR, they wanted not to see the single one, but the many body coherences. If you have many, many particles, then you can define the density matrix as superposition of the multiple quantum coherences, M. So that is the overlap between a state with M and M plus one spin. So the overlap between something that has M magnetization and M plus M. So, and you can see for a spin three, for example, you have 3/2 to minus 3/2. The diagonal parts have M equal to zero. Then the connection between 3/2 and 1/2 have M equal to one, M equal to two, and so forth. And if you go, the streams, of course, are the ones that tell you the catness of the state. If you have a cat state, then you have non-zero components in these extremes. So these objects IM that I read in my autox are actually called multiple quantum intensities, and is the trace of rho minus m rho m. And for the case of I zero, is trace of rho zero square. So you can clearly see that, you can clearly see that I'm measuring kind of a purity. It's just so that you can see that there is indirect connection to Reinian entropy in somehow, but I'm measuring a purity in coherent space, not a purity in space, in dimensional space. So that's one point. So one way that I see the photox that I like, I think is associated with this painter, Italian painter in the 50s. And I think he anticipated the idea of these photox, of this scrambling, because what he told us is that if you look locally, you miss a lot of information. And only when you look at the many body system as a whole is when what you can extract what is really happening. So if I look locally, I only going to see these birds or fish. I don't get anything. But only when you appreciate the picture of the many body system completely as a whole, you can see the duke of the cone that he was trying to draw. So I think I visualize these photox as giving access us to these many body degrees of freedom that are hidden in the local measurements. So let me briefly start to postulate the connection between photox and quantum chaos. And for that, the only thing that I need to do is that the perturbation that I apply has to be a small, the perturbation that I apply. So it's a weak perturbation. I can do perturbation theory. And the photox, just when you do the math, is approximately 2 second order is in this rotation, is the variance of my generator of rotation G. Now, a variance is something that I'm very familiar with, that is not a complex, quantificated measurement. I can actually use phase space methods to compute variances in a many body system. I can scale it. This is nice. So it's not a, it's a complicated, it's a connection between something that is simple to understand. But second, it gives a direct connection between the Lyapunov exponent of the quantum system, that is the growth of F, and the classical exponent, that is the growth of the classical trajectory of this observable. So if the observable grows with a Lyapunov exponent lambda L, then because this is a variance, is the square of it, then the quantum system is going to have 2L. So it gives me a direct connection in a very simple way between the two, the quantum and the classical. And of course, we are not the first one to point this out. There have been a lot of very nice work pointing it out, but you see this very clearly in this approach. The factor of two comes immediately. Not only that, but now we can do simulations. So we choose G to be the displacement, E plus A daga, this rotation, and we could go to huge systems, 10 to the 8. Not, of course, experimentally realistic, but we could try to see clearly what is the growth of the scrambling through this small angle perturbation. And what we can see as we increase the system size is that the photons saturate at some point that we call a scrambling time, or is known as scrambling time. And in our system, this scrambling time scales as logarithmic of n. So that's one of the characteristics of that we were seeing finally exponential growth. And second, this is in this T star, well, is clearly this logarithmic behavior. And then this lambda exponent, on the other hand, is independent of n and actually fully agree being a factor of two of the classical exponent. So we did the comparisons for an state starting with the critical energy. And we can see that at this point, that's where the point we found largest the Lyapunov exponent in the classical system as we change B. I mean, this is in the super radiant, this is the normal phase. We clearly see the factor of two in both. And if we go to another state that has smaller Lyapunov exponent, we still see the transition between, the factor of two is clear and the transition between the super radiant to normal phase. Okay, so we have made the first link. Mm-hmm. Let me go back and try to, in the next 10 minutes, try to tell you a little bit more about the connection between these photons and the Rayne entropy. That was the ingredient that we were missing, and that's the one that we really want to measure. So go back, remember that the Rayne entropy, we partite the system in two, and in this case, what we are interested in first is imagine that we have the spins and the phonons. We trace over the spins and we try to look at the purity of the phonons or vice versa. Of course, let me point out that we are not the first one. Of course, in the quantum information community, they have already shown mathematically that the Rayne entropy, if you have a system at thermal equilibrium at some temperature beta, you quench the system with an observable O and you try to compute the Rayne entropy, then they find this mathematical equality that looks like an autox. This W is an operator that acts in the other. If you want to have the Rayne entropy of system A, the W operator is any subset of operators acting of the system B. It has to be a complete basis, complete set of operators. So it's very large. So you have to do the sum over this very large sum, but there is an equality between these two. The point that I want to make, I mean, this looks very complicated. If you can clearly see it, if you identify this object as the B, of the B operator of the autox, you get BW. So, but the point, imagine we are working at zero temperature. We are starting with pure states. So beta going to infinity, zero temperature, you can see that this B, this is a projection in the ground state. And therefore this B becomes the fidelity of an initial state after the quench. So this telling you that photox is indirectly showing there. But I'm going to show you more concretely what is the link. So, this is a Norfolk slide. I mean, it has it's dense. Hopefully, I can go very quickly. The idea is that if I write the density matrix of my spins and my phonons, I can write. This is exact. N is the Fox. Is the quantum number A of the Fox state number of occupation of the phonons. And if I look at go to a basis of a spin pointing along the R direction, then I have this MR projection. This is a complete basis of my spin. So I can sum over the spin, I can sum over the phonons, and then this is an exact equality. Now, if I compute the Rayne entropy as a tracing over one of those, you mathematically can show that this has four terms. The first term is associated with I can, if I have the G to be a rotation, then give me the multiple quantum coherences M equal to zero of this photon when I add a rotation only on the spins. If I add on, I have a rotation that is G acting on the phonons, then this other term is the multiple quantum coherences, M equal to zero for the phonons. So these are measurement by Ottox protocol. These two other quantities are not. One is a diagonal component that is small, actually, and the other is off-diagonal components that they can be large, but if the system is scrambled information, the system decoheres and this quantity goes to zero. So at the end, the dominant terms during the dynamics are these Ottox, that is the Fourier transform of an Ottox. So if I'm able to measure the Ottox, I will have information of the range entropy. That is nice. That's what we wanted to get. And just to show that you that it does work, we start with an spins all pointing along the x direction, zero phonons, and I'm going to look at the time evolution. Let me look at the chaotic phase, and I compute these two Ottox and as a function of time. I do rotations, try to actually optimize the scrambling. So at the direction at which the Lyapunov exponent is larger, I choose the rotation at a given time. And we can see that by doing that, the Rényi entropy as a function of time of the system, my computation in terms of the Ottox agree very well. At short times, system of course has not scrambled but we choose an initial condition such that there is no coherence at time t equal to zero. So it's only a small step where the coherence are non-zero, where there is some disagreement, as you can see here, but it agrees very well. And again, even if the system is not chaotic, like in the normal phase, still I can choose initial conditions such that the coherences are zero and the phonons that are the ones that are the phonons that are not very much participating, I can choose conditions so that these two terms cancel out and I can still see the agreement between the Ottox and the Rényi entropy. So, but the important part is here, if I plot the Rényi entropy time average as a function of time in the different phases, I see that the Rényi entropy doesn't grow in the normal phase, and in the superradiant phase where there is chaos, you see the Rényi entropy grows increasingly with I approach the more with this B as make B smaller than the Rényi entropy grows. And not only that, but if I look at my Rényi entropy, that is the black dots, and I compute the Rényi entropy by approximating by the sum of these two Ottox, I see that they agree very well. So one point is that I'm showing that the system does explore a lot of the Hilbert space in the chaotic region, and there is a one to correspond between Rényi entropy and Ottox. That's what we wanted to see. Maybe if you are more ambitious and you want to see how the Rényi entropy grows with system size, I can also do Ottox where one of the subsystems is a pair of my spins and the other subsystem is the spins and the phonons. So I can do only rotations, a photo where the rotation is only here and a photo when the rotation and the rotation is in the rest of the spin and the phonons. What I'm showing here is as a function of the system size in the chaotic region, we see a growth of the Rényi entropy with system size, that is volume law scaling. We can compare, this is the Rényi entropy exactly, and this is the Rényi entropy computed from the photons, and they kind of agree. But also we can see that the Rényi entropy, if I assume that the system thermalized and I compute the Rényi entropy assuming a thermal ensemble, they fully agree with my calculation from the photons. So it works. And the system also finally, if I try to look at what is the density matrix, the distribution, the density matrix in terms of the spins and the photons, and I compare with a fully thermalized system or a diagonal ensemble, which that is the solid line, they agree. So I know that I'm going fast over this, but it has a lot of details. The story is that Ottox can access to Rényi entropy, and this is something that can be measured in the experiment for large number of spins. So that's the goal. Where are we in the experiment? We measure Ottox in the case where there was no transfer field, that was done when we measured the magnetization measurements too. This is only involves the spins, so it's just the simple Ising model. The reversal is by changing delta to minus delta. The problem that we had is that it's a fidelity measurement, and fidelity are very strongly susceptible to decoherence. So it's not the factor of gamma that is the decoherence, it's n gamma. So it was hard to distinguish how much, well, I mean, we could distinguish, but the decay from decoherence was dominant, and this was unfortunate. So the next step that we are following is, well, now for the decay model, we need to also to reverse not only the phonons, but the spins. And this is something that we could trivially do by doing an spin echo in the middle. So the time reversal is under control. And if we want to measure photons, we not only measure the fidelity of being all dark, that is what we all down, but we also need to measure the possibility of being zero photons, that is going to be the initial state. And this is doable. I mean, there has been prior experiments that have done that, and we will proceed with the same protocol. The idea is that if you have all the spins dark, they don't scatter photons. So it's not going to be destroyed. We are not going to destroy them. I mean, they are complementary. The measurements of zero photons, zero phonons, and all dark are doable together. So that's work in progress. And the last part, and this is the trickiest one, is to control the coherence. We want to have dynamics much faster than the decoherence rate. And the experimentalists are trying to use a paramagnetic drive that will increase the coupling constant by a factor of 10, making this ratio larger. And just, I will finalize by showing that, in fact, in the theory, we compute what the experiment would see if they add this decoherence. We can see that if this is the Rainy entropy that we expect from the ideal system, the effect of decoherence is just to introduce a shift, but doesn't change the shape on the growth in the norm in the super radiant phase. That is what we would like to see. So the experiment is growing in progress. Hopefully soon we can report this type of measurements. But with that, I just want to finish saying, well, there are great possibilities offered by your photons. And there are many questions that we don't know. What are the bones of scrambling if you have not a black hole, but a microscopic system where microscopic degrees of freedom matter? Is there a bone of scrambling? Can we really see, I mean, we saw exponential growth, but I mean, from that to connections to really what is happening in black holes and the connection between quantum chaos. I mean, there are many open questions there, but I think in the future, we should be able to address, and in particular, what are the extra ingredients that we need to add to our system to really make claim that this system could be used as a dual black hole through the holographic principle. So with that, hopefully I convey some of the excitement and all the progress that is happening in John's lab. And you can look at this reference if you want more details, and thank you for your attention.
Okay, thanks a lot for this great talk. I really enjoyed it, and I'm also now really excited about all of these developments, which is also clear from the questions. So we already have a few of them. So first of all, two questions about the effective model where the Hamiltonian is proportional to SZ squared. Mm-hmm. So first is that the model is clearly integrable. In which sense does the speaker use thermalization there, or how does these depend on thermalization?
Yes, so I mean, it's integrable. And as we see, we are going to have collapses and revivals. That's something that we will note. That's the first part that is clear. But for us, thermalization means entanglement. And we know that even in this trivial model, there is entanglement generated. So, I mean, what we use for thermalization, and let me, maybe it's better to, if I go to my first talk, it's revealed in one of my first slides, where we show that only local observables are going to thermalize. If I go to various spin, 2 or 3 and 4, I will not see volume low. I mean, it's not that this is going to saturate here and I'm going to the maximum value. And when I go to 2, 3, 4, I'm going to have this volume low growth. No, it's going to be very different. It's going to be much slower. That's what I mean by it's thermalization, but it's not volume low.
Okay, thanks. And then the follow-up question that is, how quantum is this large spin model? I would expect it to be fairly well described by semi-classics.
Well, yes, that's a misconception in some sense. Because I think it depends on what you measure. I mean, I can show you that at this time of the evolution, so you let the system start along all the atoms along the X direction, let it evolve, and you can see that this revivals because it's an integrable system after some time, because this, of course, the quantum number M is an integer, so multiples of 2 pi, of course, is going to revive. But you can see that at the middle of the evolution, the system forms a cat state. I don't think anything can be more quantum than a cat state. So yeah, and depends on what you mentioned, you are going to look at ground state. I agree, the ground state is trivial. I mean, the ground state is we know the basis, the ground state doesn't have any entanglement. But when you do dynamics, you are going to have coherent superposition of the states, and they can be highly entangled as a cat state. So look, for example, not this all-to-all system, but nearest neighbor Ising model generates cluster states that are the states that are multipartite entanglement used for quantum computation. So it's a misleading to say that if the system has a classical ground state or excited state, superposition of them cannot be highly quantum.
Great, thanks. So there are also people in the chat thanking you and sending clapping emojis, which is a good sign. Then an additional question, what is the relation between photons and the Loschmidt echo?
It's very connected. I think it depends of, it's highly connected. You can see that the Loschmidt echo is also at the overlap between two states, so two quantum states. So you can see it kind of as a type of Loschmidt echo. That's what I'm saying. It's not something new. NMR people taught us photons for many years. It's just the interpretation. So yes, but I think you can see that when I look at my photons. When I look at here, let me see. Yes, so if you look at the evolution at the end, I am going to have, because it's a fidelity measurement, what I'm going to have is the overlap, the photons is the overlap between my initial state and the state that has been perturbed by the time evolved state after the perturbation of the W. So it's going to be phi of t, and then five of t, and in the middle W. So it's an initial state and another state when I have applied a perturbation W. So yes, I think you can see it as a Loschmidt echo. We are trying to look a little bit more how it changes with the rotation. I mean, I don't think it's completely a new concept. It has been developed before, but it's the way that the context, this concept is connected to other relevant quantities. That is what make it exciting. So trying to see this is telling me information about entanglement entropy, for example. That's the new part that I think is here.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, I think that should answer the question. Then an additional question is the relationship between the presence of excited state quantum phase transitions and the kind of energy level spacings general, and not just limited to the Dicker model?
This is a complicated question. I don't know. I don't actually, even in the maybe the answer is no, because in the Dicker model, even there is a controversy of what degree the chaos is associated with this excited state phase transition. And that there has been a lot of papers saying that it's only a coincidence that is there or not. There is a dynamical phase transition. So there are still, I think, many, many points that needs to be investigated in this system. So I think the honest answer is, I don't know, but most likely no, because even in the Dicker model, it's not clear that these are two directly connected. I mean, looks like, but maybe it's just a coincidence.
Okay, thanks. I think then the final question, you showed a plot in which you estimated slash measured decoherence. How did you do that?
Yeah, very simple. The point is that in the experiment, they cannot apply the many body Hamiltonian. If you don't generate add the lasers that generate the coupling between the spins and the phonons, then there is no interaction Hamiltonian. So if you let this, what you do is that you start with all the spins down, rotate them along the X direction, and let them do nothing except the coherence. And from that, you can try to see what is the effect of light scattering only. So there is a way in the experiment that they can see what is the dynamics between without having the need to have the spin Hamiltonian. And that's what we plot here. And this is, we put this decoherence in our Hamiltonian in order to reproduce the other plots, to solve a master equation.
Okay, thanks. So I think this concludes this talk. Thanks again for giving this great presentation. Thanks to everyone who's watching. And next week, we'll be back with Pavel Kos from the University of Ljubljana. And he'll be talking about solvable chaotic many-body quantum systems. So if you want to get updates, you can just subscribe to this channel, or you can subscribe to the mailing list through the link in the description of this video. Thanks again, and hopefully see you next week.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Ana Maria. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.